2 Corinthians 16:9. Listen to this. For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth. Why? To show himself. If you got your app right there. To show himself. Roger's saying faithful, but the King James says to show himself strong. Strong. Faithful. To show himself strong in the behalf of them whose heart is perfect toward him. Everybody say perfect heart. How many of you can have a heart right and still make boo-boos? Let me just go there since y'all don't mind if I follow the Holy Spirit, do you? You know, you can have a thought and it not be sinful. You can be tempted and not sin. He that knoweth to do good and not do it, to him it's sin. For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to do what? Because God's looking for opportunities to show himself strong and faithful to those who have a heart that's pursuing God. Herein thou shalt, but now watch what he says here. Most time we quit reading that scripture just about right there. But listen to the rest of the scripture. Herein thou hast done foolishly, therefore from henceforth ye shall have wars. You know, I've been pastoring this church over 29 years. And every time I see God start moving in a very demonstrative way in the spirit, wanting to break out, the devil shows out. The Lord spoke this to me, and I posted this Monday. Everybody gets excited about breakthrough. Woo, breakthrough's coming. Glory to God, breakthrough. Now stop and think about that. Why are you excited about breakthrough? Because you're needing one. And if you're needing a breakthrough, it's because you're facing all this demonic and or circumstantial physical difficulties and challenges. Is that true? So yeah, we get excited about breakthrough, but you know, what about if you're not facing some sort of a challenge? Yeah, breakthrough's great. But what's greater is living in what's been broke through. So let me use this as a context. How many of you believe that according to the blood of Jesus and Psalms 103, 1 through 3, and 1 Peter 2:22 or thereabouts, 3 and 4, you believe in divine healing, that if you're sick and you go to the doctor and the doctor says, yep, you're sick, and you'll take this and you can take the medicine and you can also believe God and you can be healed. You lack divine healing. Isn't that great? How many of you like it? You think it's great? But you know what's better than divine healing? Divine health. Because you know, if I just see somebody vomit, I gag. You know what I'm saying? So I like being well. And I'm still learning, but I've also learned that sometimes my body tells me when I need to slow down because my body's getting weary. And if you get weary, your immune system can get weary. And the thing that you were able last week to stand in faith and ward off because you're drinking water, exercise, and eating right, you know, we can do that a couple of days, generally from January 1st to about the 5th, you know, your resolution. But when I get weary, one of the things happens in me physically is I kind of get nasally. I feel it in my, look at me. You understand why God uses that? That is not funny. Why are y'all... But I feel the congestion, my weariness manifest up here. And so what I endeavor to do is slow down and get some extra rest. And in the midst of that, I don't say, oh my God, I think I'm getting sick. I'm not going to prophesy that. I just immediately recognize my body is giving signals. How many of you know your body will send signals? If you don't believe that, come up here and I'll let you stick your hand in that door and I'll pull it too. Your body will send a signal and your mouth will let us know what the signal was. So divine health is good. Divine healing is great. Divine health is greater. So we can't ignore some of those things. But the Lord wants to show himself strong and faithful. And he says, but you've done foolishly. Therefore, from henceforth, you shall have wars. Well, if I'm going to have wars and I make some dumb mistakes, I want to be ready. Now, how many veterans do we have in here tonight? I know two. There's one. How many of you have had, like I did, I had RVN training, Republic of Vietnam training, because I came down on orders for Vietnam, so they gave me special training. Did anybody have any special training in the military? How many of you had basic training? So you got some training. I mean, you know, basic training. You go out to the pits, and they give each one of the guys, one at a time with the drill instructor, a hand grenade, a live hand grenade, a live one. And they tell you, now, if you drop this, do not try to pick it up. Get over this concrete wall. So we all got to throw one hand grenade. We all got to shoot our weapons. We went out in bivouac, and they shot us with BB guns. The DIs up in the woods shooting us with BB guns. That ain't right unless you're the DI, drill instructor. But we got training. If you have any inclination that somewhere over the next weeks, months, and years of your life you might make a foolish choice, and you might do something that would compromise your Christian walk, you're going to face wars. So if it's possible I could make a poor choice, and if it's probable I'm going to face war, I want to face war prepared. And part of what church is a whole bunch of folks that need to be in training, because we are facing spiritual warfare. And I have found in my 29 plus years of pastoring this church that we founded is that every time God starts moving, so does the devil. What's he going to do? He's going to try to disrupt what God's trying to do. You say, well, the devil can't stop God. How many of you know you can? Without faith, it's impossible to please God. And God doesn't answer. Listen, I know, sit up. Sit up, boys and girls. God does not simply answer prayer. He answers prayer of faith. Let me give you an example. God, I'm going through it. Oh, God, this is terrible. And so what God's supposed to do with that? Oh, Lord, I'm going to intercede now. Oh, Lord, people are going through it. Oh, God, this is an old rugged road down here. It's dusty and tired. That's communicating with God. Well, he ain't going to answer that. The only thing he could say is, yes. But there's nothing he can respond to. But you can pray, Father God, I thank you in the midst of the struggle, Jesus has made a way. In the same way he made a way for Moses and the children of Israel and split the sea and they walked through on dry ground, I'm coming through on dry ground. I'm coming through the other side with Miriam and her tambourine. Come on, somebody. And the Lord will say, yes. Father, I ask you to move powerfully upon this church and upon every person, every heart, and every head in it. Father, I thank you according to your word. My family will be saved. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saving your whole house. Oh, Lord God, I thank you as I stand in the gap and make up the hedge for my family and for my church family. Lord, I thank you're going to move mightily and you're going to open eyes and cause stiff necks to become soft and hard hearts to be made pure. And you'll take out that. God will answer that.
Have you ever considered a Christian education for your child? Then you should check out Arkansas Christian Academy, Saline County's fully accredited premier Christian school at an affordable family rate. Students have opportunities to excel in academics, athletics, fine arts, and technology. And through our dual enrollment program, high school students can even achieve an associate's degree prior to graduation. Visit us at ArkansasChristianAcademy.org.
God sought for a man that would make up the hedge. Why? Because there's a gap, and there are times that we do foolishly. God bless us, but sometimes we do foolishly. Sometimes because of lust of the flesh or something. Sometimes just because we just made a bad choice. And there's a gap, and the devil says, here's a gap in the hedge. We planted those red tip fatimas, and as soon as I started planting, I say it was a work day, it was a whole bunch of us out there planting them. And the people that brought them from the nursery said, "Now, you know, these have a tendency to get fungus." And I said, "Don't speak out over these red tips. These are holy red tips." And red tips were getting fungus all over Saline County. And they said, "Whoa, you got all those red tips. You know, they're getting fungus." I said, "Not ours. I prophesy they'll live and not die." And over, people said that our red tips would get fungus until about year 15, with some gaps in the hedges, they got fungus. Somebody did foolishly. You know, if two or three people agree it's touching anything, and they touched our red tips, so we just cut them all down. Thank you for your encouragement. I don't know why y'all need to hear that. He said, "I saw for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap." Now, what he's saying is when there's gaps, you and I, as children of God, can come boldly into his throne room in time of need and stand in the gaps that our children are making, stand in the gaps that other Christians are making, stand in the gap on behalf of our family members that aren't saved and some of those family members that are saved but just not serving God. We can stand in the gap and say, "Father God, I thank you that the Holy Spirit knows neither time, space. He's not hindered in any way. He's moving right now. He's drawing people. He's pouring out his wisdom. He's pouring out his ability and his power. I stand in the gap and I make up the hedge in the name of Jesus, fighting with both hands." Come on, somebody. Y'all been here or not? Just one person. Now, it's great if you can find somebody else that's just one person. And two of you agree, it's touching anything in heaven and it shall be done. And Jesus said, "Whatsoever you ask in my name," what? "I'll ask the Father and he'll do it." I could go in some other directions, but I got some other stuff I want to share with you. So I'm going to share one of my favorite poems. "Give me a man of God," and I'm only sharing two stanzas of four stanzas, just because I just want you to hear this. "Give me a man of God, a woman of God, one person whose faith is master of his mind." Whose faith is master of his mind. Faith is not in the head. Say that with me. Faith is not in my head. That's mental assent. That's mental agreement. Nothing wrong with being in mental agreement with the Word of God, but faith is of the heart. Faith is of the Spirit. This is where the Word is received, is in the Spirit. And then that is where faith comes from. And this is what transforms and renews or restoreth, Psalms 23, the soul. Whose faith is master of his mind. That when your mind's saying one thing that's contrary to the Word, your spirit, where David said, "I have hid your Word in my heart." Now, we don't technically hide the Word in our heart. But what he's saying is, I've spent time in your Word and I've spent time in your presence, and that Word is here. "I have hid your Word in my heart that I sin not against you." In other words, my mind is not going to talk me out of what my spirit knows. Come on. I am really teaching good tonight. Help me out. You've learned about red tips. You've heard about hedges and bread trucks. "Whose faith is master of his mind, and I will right all wrongs and bless the name of all mankind. Give me one man, a man of God, a woman of God, whose tongue is touched with heaven's fire." That whenever your brain is telling you one thing, your tongue touched by the fire of God, filled with the Word of God, your tongue is a pen of a ready writer, that your tongue says to your brain, "Shut up. You're not in charge. I cast you down and I bring you into captivity," and you say, "By his stripes I'm healed and everything I touch prospers." Come on. "And I will flame the darkest hearts and high resolve with clean desire." You notice the clean desire is connected with a tongue that's touched with heaven's fire. That's just a poem. But did you know that one person... Want to put 1,000 flat, to put 10,000 flat. But if I can't find somebody to agree with me and Jesus will be in agreement. And one person with God in faith is a majority. You remember, just because everybody says it's right, don't make it right. And just because everybody says it's wrong, don't make it wrong. Christianity is not majority rules. Christianity is Jesus rules. One person with God in faith is a majority. Now, Hebrews 11:32 says, "What more shall I say? For the time shall fail me to tell of Gideon and of Barak and of Samson and Jephthah and David and Samuel." He named all these individuals. They didn't all live at the same time. They didn't all do the same thing. They didn't even have the same personality types. Who through faith, not their mental prowess, their high intellect, their PhD, their master's degree, their BS degree, Bachelor of Science, not through their intellect, not through their talent and ability, but through faith. Now let me explain something. Through faith. Oh, if I just had more faith. No, that's great to have more faith. But Jesus said, if you have faith as a mustard seed, use what you have. It's as much as you can have great faith, it's having faith in a great God. And if you have faith in a great God, your faith will get greater. I'm glad I came tonight. Who through faith, everybody say faith. Not through their own prowess. He talked about Gideon here. We told you the story of Gideon. You've heard the story. You may have taught the story. He's got all these soldiers. The soldiers come. I'll get to there in a little bit. And God whittles it down to 300. Why? So he would have to trust God. And how'd they beat the enemy? A torch, a trumpet, and a clay vessel. And all doing, now this is it right here, all doing what they saw Gideon doing. So simple. So if you want to be successful in the things of God, find somebody that is doing and has completely done and been successful doing what you want to do. That's why Paul said, follow me as I follow the Lord. Paul the apostle said, I'm doing everything in my ability to do WWJD so I can get that rubber bracelet. I'm doing everything I can to do what Jesus would do. Now follow me as I follow the Lord. Watch me, imitate me, and be imitators of God. All right, so who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, waxed violent in fight, turned to fight the armies of the aliens. Ooh, aliens? UFOs? Okay, y'all quit messing with me. 35, women received their dead raised to life again. Wow. And others were tortured. Now, I don't want to read that. I don't read about torturing. I don't want to read about cruel mockings and scourgings, bonds. Well, I don't mind investing in bonds, you know, to counterweight my name. Anyway. And imprisonments. You know, the Apostle Paul was an investor. He was in stocks and bonds often. Boy, you are hard on a fella. And others had trial of cruel mockings and scourgings, yet moreover of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned. Wait a minute, I thought you said I had faith. No, I warned you about wars. Just because you're in a war doesn't mean you don't have faith. But I assure you, if you're in a war, and we are, you better understand faith and understand why you need to stay in the things of God and stay in the community of God. So this word of God that is sharper than any two-edged sword, you understand how to use it in the midst of the battles.
Hi, I'm Perry Black right here at Destined Win TV, and I want to share some good news with those of you in local churches around the state of Arkansas that have a small youth group and need a great summer camp to go to. You know, I founded Destined to Win Fired Up for Jesus Summer Camp in 1984 for young people just like those you minister to at your church week after week. You don't want to miss this opportunity coming this summer right here in Arkansas, and we would love to have you join us in our 35th annual Destined to Win Fired Up for Jesus Summer Camp. More details to follow. God bless you. I look forward to hearing from you.
Paul said, you know, woe to me if after I preach to others, I myself become a castaway. Paul said, you know what, I haven't yet obtained. Oh, yeah, if I could just be like brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so or that favorite author of mine that writes all these Christian books or the ones I'm watching on YouTube or on TV, if I could just be like them, they'd never have a problem. Are you kidding me? I watched Perry Stone the other night. It was a message from a long time ago. It was one of the best messages I've heard in a long time. And a lot of times that's simply because it was the right time for me to hear it. And he said, sometimes I look at, you see, somebody says, oh, man, I'd love to have an anointing on my life like that guy right there. I'd love to have that kind of anointing on me. And he said, I don't look at them like that. He said, I look at them and say, my Lord, what have they gone through to get that anointing right there? Sometimes you got to pass through hell to walk in heaven. You know what I'm saying? You say, well, I guess old Pastor Perry never has a problem in the world. No, I got about 1,000 of them. Now, I love y'all. Y'all are job security. Ain't no way I'm working my way out of business in this life, is there? Because sometimes y'all do foolish stuff. I do too. Look what I just did. I called you by name. But say, I'm not that dumb. I did it after the offering. Come on. Okay. But you know, I will tell you this. If I ever call you out by name, it's because I love you. I'll never call you out if there's something between us. So if I call you by name, Roger, it's because I'm confident we have a relationship. I can pick on you, and you won't do anything until Sunday in your class and pick back on me when I'm not there to defend myself. All right. So others had cruel mockings. But see, faith is in the good times. Faith is when you're walking in the favor of God, in the grace of God, and it looks like you don't have a problem in the world. You ever get up one of those days, it's just like, man, I could conquer the world. Woohoo! I'm a champion! And the next day, your hormones are like, and your husband says one thing, he's like, let's not talk about the men because they're bigger than me. But a lot of times, it doesn't matter. Just because you're in a war, just because you're under attack, just because you even made a poor choice, doesn't mean the favor of God's still not available. It doesn't mean the grace is not still working. But sometimes even in that grace, we just say, oh, God, just give me some mercy up in here. But I know if I won't quit, you're going to bring me through this. Raise your hand if you want to be thrown, tied up, and thrown in a fiery furnace. Yeah, but I tell you, I love to hear about Shadrach, Meshach, and Shambach. I just love to hear about those characters. I mean to tell you, they threw them in a fiery furnace. It was awesome. And the king looked in, praise God, can I get a glory? And the king looked in and said, well, did we not throw in three? Do I not see a fourth man? Does he not look like the Son of God? Whoa, what a story. Aren't you glad it was them? But you read Hebrews, this hall of fame, and it says these people in faith. Some of them, they refuse deliverance. And what do most of us do when there's some little attack? Oh, God, please come on through. Jesus, get me out of this little flicker. Devil just look at you and flick his beak, and you're like, avity, avity, avity. Man, I love that. He said, you know, you look at somebody under the anointing and say, oh, man, if I could just have that. And he said, I look at them and say, man, what hell have they gone through to be able to walk in that anointing? Now, I'm not preaching pain and aggravation and all that. I'm just telling you, if you don't think, here's the lie. Just give your life to Jesus, you'll never have another problem. Well, the first problem with that is this person's lying to you. The first thing that's going to happen to you when you give your life to Jesus, you get filled with the Holy Ghost. The devil's coming to take you down to see if he can get you before you get strong in faith and find out that God is watching over you so he can show himself faithful and strong on your behalf. And I'm just telling you, if he can't stop you, he's going to do everything he can to stop everybody around you and everybody as close to you as he can get to you. Everybody just do this right here. Bring it on, sucker. Say with me, by his stripes, I'm healed. Just like the song we sang, I am a child of God. Ain't nothing the devil can do about that. That's why it works so hard to convince you that your foolish mistakes or your choices or decisions or you're all out living for God and the attacks are there, that something must be wrong with you. You are not the problem. The devil is. You ought to be his biggest headache. Of whom the world was not worthy, they wandered in deserts and in mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. Listen to this. And these all, from 11:1 all the way to verse 39, and these all, having obtained a good report through faith. Let's think about that. That sounded pretty good. A good report through faith. Praise God, I got a good report. Well, some of these folks got the good report after they'd already lost their heads for Jesus. Some of these got a good report while they were in the lion's den. Most of us just want a good report. I ain't never had a problem. I think some of us need to go around to everyone we've ever witnessed to and one to the Lord and let them in the sinner's prayer by telling them, if you give your life to Jesus, you'll never have another problem. We tell them life's a bed of roses. Anybody here got roses? How many of you know what's in a bed of roses? Thorns. And I'm telling you, life is challenging. Is that true? Sometimes life can be hard. Is that true? So if you're going to have to face it, why face it in the flesh? Why face it in your natural carnal ability? Why not just say, I've tore down these altars in the name of Jesus and I've built my altar to God. I lay my life on it and allow the Spirit of God to come on you to fill you up to overflowing so that when the attack comes, you know, I'm like a Baptist. I shall not be moved. I'm going to stand because it's the Spirit of God in which I stand in His holy power. Anybody in here need a refill?
Hi, I'm Perry Black right here at Destined to Win TV, and I want to say thank you for watching our program. You know, we'd love to connect with you, and one way you can do that is join us right here at Family Church Bryant on Sunday morning or on Wednesday night. As you well know, we teach straight from the Word of God with a touch of humor to make the medicine go down. You know, we believe here at Family Church, a church alive is worth the drive. And if you're not connected with a local church, then why don't you visit us? Information right here on the screen. Until then, I'll see you right here at Destined to Win TV. God bless.